hard to do. A throat chakra 25% bigger, that's enough to be in the choir. 50% bigger, that's enough to be an amplifier on the floor for the choir. Double size, basically doesn't happen too often.
So we're going to expect
can
some solos out
of you. Can you hear me say that?
Hello.
Okay, so your name, please.
Sheryl.
Who did I say was the know-it-all? There she is. Forget it. You're fired. This is what know-it-alls are like.
I said, is there a life purpose where you get to be a bitch?
So I find that a very interesting response, even though you were being playful about it. Did I say anything bitchy?
No, not at all. I was talking about myself. I was wondering if this is my excuse.
Did I use the B word?
No.
No, but you did, didn't you?
Yes.
I pay very close attention to what people say, and I call that dialogue disguise ears. And in a reading, people will tell you everything if you're able to look at the hand and interpret. Mm-hmm. Am I talking loud enough?
No, I'm fine.
Okay. Good. I might lapse to shorter, you know, to lower, and then just tell me. I'll lapse the other way. No, this is clearly a know-it-all hand, and this is a very pushy, dynamic, and I am not suggesting that any of us need to be a different type of person than we are. That's rule number one. Be the type that you is, but be appropriate with that type.
Right.
Being a bitch would be an inappropriate use of that. You heard me give the mother-in-law example. If you're my mother-in-law, if you're in the elevator, I'm just trying to get to the sixth floor. I don't need your advice, you know. I don't know you, lady. But if you're my tennis coach, how much per hour? You know, you're the only reason I'm doing well. So it's your job, both of you, to find the appropriate license, the appropriate arena for your ability to understand things. It's not so much your ability to figure things out. That's not it. You understand things in a different way. And the way you understand things is not the way that only one person for 250 is the know-it-all. You happen to have a know-it-all congregation, I think it has something to do with you. Remember, I say know-it-all with high praise. Again, it's a special arrangement of the third eye that allows a certain discernment that's not available to people without that equipment. And it's actually invisible to them. That which is clear and obvious is not clear and obvious to the other 99.64% of the population. And you can't stop your brain from producing that type of thinking. You can ask it to stop. It doesn't listen to you. Just like you can tell your ears, I don't want to hear what's going on. Your ears hear whether they don't go on and off. You can close your eyes, but you know, what do? Close your ears.
Right.
So you can't stop that process. What you can do is arrange it so that you're in the right position of deployment with that. And it's absolutely crucial for you to find a good deployment. And it's not just even that you're the know-it-all. You're a non-stop know-it-all. And it's like that part of you is on steroids. That's why I said you're demoted to two-star general here. And that part on steroids, I consider very, very high praise. And it's like you were in the cosmic laboratory, and you were talking to your guardian angel, who looked kind of like this, and you were discussing how to build me this lifetime coming up. And you asked for that special third eye sauce, and you said, I want a gallon. They said, a gallon? I'm going to have to call the home office. So you waited while they called the home office, and you just poured it in before they got permission. And then your guardian angel's hair caught on fire, and poof, next thing you know, you're getting a reading.
Yeah.
Holy cow. Did you have permission to get that much of it?
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, you're a guardian angel. Said, well, what can you do? You can't stop humans sometimes. You know, she'll deal with it. Okay, so you think you know better what everybody should do. You have any kids?
Two.
Yeah, do they want to hear you telling them what to do?
No, they're teenagers.
Right. And yet, there they are, driving off the cliff at 90 miles an hour. What are you supposed to do? Keep your mouth shut?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I have advice for you. I'm a know-it-all. I have advice. Okay. If you're able to give advice to large numbers of people, general public, people you don't care about because you don't even know who they are, you know, strangers, the general public. When you come home, your advice giver will have used up most of her juice, and you won't impose it inappropriately on the people close to you. But if you don't have a job where you do hours and hours of that, you'll be like this blasting, loud, you know, boombox, and your children won't speak to you. Or you'll keep your mouth shut, and you'll watch them drive over the cliff when you knew that they were going headlong at it. You have no choice, basically, from where I sit, but to bring your insight to the general public. Your insight is like too strong for a small territory. And if you were a therapist working one-to-one with people, that would be good, but ultimately that would also be too small an audience for you. Your design, your equipment, is to know it all for the general public. That's to give advice to people that you don't even know are getting your advice. That's interesting that you're built that way.
Would she be good for like a radio talk show?
That could work. That could work. Because then people would be getting advice who you don't even know. All sorts of juicy stuff. We got a loop tented arch here, we got a whirl there, we got 8 loops elsewhere, and we got 1 minute to tell you what that all means. Or under 1 minute to tell you what that all means. Okay, so are you getting a lot of negative flack from people all over the place?
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you weren't, that would be a bad sign. At your best, you're so good at dealing with criticism that you're able to preach to the non-choir and you're able to bring wisdom to people that start off being your biggest critics, and they ultimately become your cheering section. And that's supposed to be on the large scale. And if you're not doing it out there, the criticism is going to come from the small scale in places that you don't like it. That is very hurtful, basically from the family.
Okay.
You won't be what the family people want you to be, they say. They're going to tell you that you're not right the way you are. And just like I said before, the more you're doing your advice to the world, the better your family relationships are going to be. Isn't that interesting?
Mm-hmm.
Your family relationships don't go as well when you're not boomboxing your advice.
Interesting.
But you're supposed to be boomboxing it to strangers, not them. That's your reading.
Thank you.
More Facebook.
Hi, I'm Anna.
Anna Bobana. Okay, let's see about you, Anna. Okay. Let me take a look through my magnifier here. Can you get the let's get you that way. There we go. Excellent. Oh, okay. Good enough. Now, I need you at a slightly different angle. There we go. Good. I like the star of Saturn much better than there's hardly a star of Jupiter there. Okay. So, do you work? Do you mind telling me what you do? Is part of what you do creating networks of human interaction, that you are the reason that this network exists? That's an interesting one for you to think on. I'm suggesting that you are a hub person. We were talking about hubba for Dottie. I'm saying that you're hubba as well. That you, at your best, create a circle of people who get benefit from being in your circle, and that somehow these people can connect to those people because you exist in the middle of that circle and you are a conduit, I'm suggesting.
I think you just did that today, didn't you? You brought us food to be distributed. And
mm-hmm.
I kind of do that at my office too.
Well, you can't, according to me, you can't not do it.
Okay.
But at your best, you do that consciously on purpose to your advantage and everybody else's advantage.
Win-win.
Well, it's more than win-win. You have an asterisk formation sitting under your middle finger left hand. That's a star of Saturn. And the star of Saturn person is, as I just described, the conduit person. And the bad news, every marker has a good news, bad news possibility. It's bad news is cobbler's son, no shoes, where everybody benefits from you except you. And that, well, the cobbler's son, no shoes. So at your best, you create networks, people benefit, and you use your networks to benefit you. Of course, a part of you says, I don't need the benefit, I don't need shoes, you know, it's okay with me, I can use my pogo stick, I don't really need any shoes. When you get to the gates of heaven, you lose 2 points for using your pogo stick. You thought you were doing something good. But there's a theme of that in this room, I'm noticing. So I'm always looking for the theme in the room I work in, because you know, I do this all the time, and the rooms are really, really different one to the next. But the standard issue for the star of Saturn person is everybody benefits, and she's on the bottom of the list. And I'm suggesting that if you are at your best, you benefit, the network gets bigger, stronger, everybody benefits more, you benefit more, the network gets bigger and stronger, everybody benefits more. It's part of the good of the group that you would be on the benefit side of the group. Let's take a look at your fingerprints. By the way, you would have been taking care of the trains. Who's my train taker care of? Yeah. You're just too slouchy.
Too slouchy?
Imagine. Yeah, you go to sleep at night? She can't go to sleep until all the trains have arrived in the station. You, as long as they look like they're arriving, can still go to sleep. Can you imagine what that's like?
Because I need my sleep.
Can you imagine what that's like over there?
Yeah, I was doing a 24-hour on-call job at one time.
She's 25 hours.
24/7.
She's 25/8. Just think about that. Okay, that's five loops. Okay, that's interesting. I need both hands.
Oh.
Yeah, thank you.
That would be 10 loops.
If you're a 10-looper, that would be interesting. You're not. That's a whirl.
Any burn marks?
No, I'm not looking for burn marks. I'm looking for fingerprints. Okay. Yeah. When I'm in Texas, I get a lot of people saying my life purpose is family. I want to be a good husband, father, mother, daughter. You know, family is what's most important, my number one priority. And usually what I tell them is that's your priority, but your fingerprints probably say something else as your purpose, because most of us have family as a major factor in our life, but very few people have family as their life purpose, but you do. So, yeah, that's interesting. It's one of the trickier life purposes. So, taking a look at your original family and what you learned that families mean, that I don't know unless I would be talking to you and finding out how that dynamic interplayed in any and all families that you've been part of, including the chess club, the girls' jump rope team in second grade, any networks that you have created and become part of, what dynamics exist in those family meetings. It doesn't have to be a blood family, but it certainly includes blood family. And any original family members that were particularly difficult in the way in which they were particularly difficult for you, a critical father, a doting, a smothering mother, any of those possibilities are extremely likely in the family life purpose, and how they get played out in disguise in the later events, these are all the things worth noting. And it's not your job necessarily to put up with family malfeasance, I'll just call it, but it is your job to grapple with the family dynamic. When you get to the gates of heaven, if you solved cancer, the Mideast problems, and you know, make a list, they'll say, that's nice, we had 18 other people who could have done that. Let's take a look at the video of you and your different families. So now that you know your pop quiz at the gates of heaven, you can start prepping.
For my families to...
Family is number one in your life purpose story.
Yeah.
What is the condition of family? Who have I not said what to? You know, what unfinished business exists? It applies to every single one of us, but not the way it applies to you.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome. Ricardo. My tech team is doing
something. Doing the tech thing.
Oh, okay. Oh, man's hands. All right. Okay.
Did you give your name?
Yeah.
I didn't hear it. And I know who he is.
Richard.
Thank you.
Okay. So what would I do with these hands? All right. Very interesting. So these hands are smart. I'm not saying the rest of you are dumb. I'm just saying that these hands are smart. And they're smart in a particular way. They have a certain, let me just check to make sure I'm not being dumb here. They have a certain task intelligence to them. However, they do not like power play bullshit at all. And I wonder, there's so many different scenarios that come to my mind. So there you are tasking away. Whatever task you wound up doing, you would apply yourself to the task in a taskmeistery way. You'd be smart about what you were doing. But if there were other people involved, which is likely with hands like yours, it's not the I initiate new projects, it's not the innovator type of hands, although who knows what's going on. But it's not that hand type. It's more likely to be part of a group doing things and your job is to do this. Okay, that means power play bullshit shows up because those are humans. And when you get enough humans, power play bullshit is inevitable. And your hands hate power play bullshit. And your tendency would be to try to be a better taskmeister as a way to deal with power play bullshit, which doesn't work with power play bullshitters. You might have learned by now. So that would be interesting to find out how you handle that. And can you... Do you move out onto your own to just get away from annoying people? That's not a bad solution. Do you find a way to insulate yourself from Fred, who's just a complete jerk, and talking to him more doesn't get anywhere with him? Do you find a way around that? Maybe. I don't know. These are the things I'd be discussing, and this is the things I'm thinking about as I'm looking at, I've only taken a glance at your hand, and these are the things that arrive in my palmistry strategy room on first glance. Okay. That's, by the way, that's almost the gifted healer. It's like 80% in. Were you here this morning?
No.
Okay. So I referred to that earlier. There's a marking that therapists, counselors, and most of my students have that most of the general population doesn't have, which is the gifted healer. That was my name for it. It's the person with psychological insight who works with other people and helps them to greater psychological insight. You have 80% of that in your hands. That's a lot of it. It's as if you've been attending those classes for years on end. But I'm still in an iffy, I wonder, you're such a taskmeister. Maybe you took a different tack. Maybe you were only deploying this partially. I don't know. Anyway, that's where I am so far. Oh, yeah. Really. What do you do when people screw with you? You really don't like it, and you have various markings in your head. Aren't you a loyal person? Wouldn't you, if you told me that you'd help me move this Sunday, and what if it snowed both ways uphill, would you still show up to help me move on Sunday? You'd probably even be an hour early and bring over some pizza or something.
No, maybe not that.
Okay. Grant me a little exaggeration.
Probably more my style.
Okay, but for melodramatic exaggeration point, aren't you that type of fellow that I can count on?
Yeah.
Right. But your hands have various markers that indicate that people who aren't like you bump into you, and then now you have to deal with them. And your hands really don't know what to do with that stuff. Betrayal, disloyalty, and petty bullshit. Your hands have markers in all those categories indicating irritation in each of those categories, which is interesting. You probably won't hear me say that. If you stay here, you probably won't hear me say that to anybody else today. But your hand has been poked at in those three spots. Okay. Interesting to consider.
Yes.
Yeah, like, what do you do to people when you say, oh, you're standing on my foot? You would expect them to say, oops, I'm sorry, and get off your foot. What do you do when the person says, yeah, but I like my foot there? Well, yeah, but they know what to do against that, too. It's Your hand has more awkwardness around that than usual.
Well, I meant that as opposed to
shooting
this. You know, I mean, it's, I'm learning to stand up for myself without being confrontational. Say.
Yeah, I understand. And, you know, I hate confrontation myself, but not as much as you do.
For myself. Other people, that's been my life. It's usually easier for somebody else is being picked on for me to stand up and say something than that.
Absolutely. As a matter of fact, the key element in your hand, you're in one of the service lifetimes also, but you're in service where you speak out. And speaking out, three quarters of your speak out assignment is speaking out for self. One quarter is speaking out for others. So the way I talk about this in palmistry class has this one over here knows. Can we turn that off when we turn it this way when we're not looking at the hand? Thank you very much. So we use the cold soup story of palmistry class. So the waitress has brought you soup that's too cold. According to your fingerprints, it's awkward for you to ask to take the soup back and get hot soup. So I use this silly story as a statement of selfish requesting. By selfish, I mean pertaining to me alone. Mm-hmm. Not like save the children, that type of requesting. So I have no way of gauging your progress on this, but your fingerprints say your progress on the cold soup test is the first question you're asked at the gates of heaven. And everything else falls in line. Every domino falls in line afterwards. If you can make personal requests and stand your ground as noise happens over your personal request, then doors open up. You pursue whatever you pursue in a way that brings you life, purpose, harvest. Life is good. If you can't send the soup back, you get stuck. And you understand I'm being metaphorical.
Yes.
But with my soup example, that's a stranger, and it's their job to bring you hot soup.
Mm-hmm.
They will probably say yes if you say, waiter, my soup is cold. What happens in life when it's more complicated? What if there's intertwining stuff? You know, they're the cousin of the uncle whose brother's sister, blah, blah, blah. Things can get very tricky in that world. Your whole life revolves around that singular issue and how you can communicate effectively around that. So you get rid of Mary in your life, you get rid of Bob, I'm talking on a life scale, have a seat. You know, people come and go, and you now are able to ask for the right soup with Mary or Bob, and then Fred shows up. Then you got to do the same thing all over again with Fred. Yeah, no end to it. So what I'm also pointing out for all of us, when stuff like that keeps happening, you haven't done anything wrong to get yourself in that circumstance. You incarnated so that there would be speak-up requirements placed upon you that you would either do decently, do terribly, do wonderfully with. There's no way you can move to the hills of Nicaragua. People would land there and bring you cold soup.
Hi, I'm Kathleen.
It's Kathleen's job to make sure those people show up. Okay, well, you're a different type of person. Let's see about you. Okay, Kathleen. Okay. You're a trickier one.
Richard, we need you to speak up.
Well, I'm mumbling to myself at the moment. That wasn't for you to hear.
I'm sorry.
What I said, if you want to hear what I said, was, oh, you're a trickier one. No, I'm going like this. Should I do that louder? On the one hand, these are like nice guy, sensitive, pliable, fluid. You know, but on the other hand, not at all. These are demanding. If it's not my way, it's the high. But I'm such a sweetie pie person. But on the other hand, there's the demanding my way or the highway. You and I'm trying to figure out how these parts Are you with him, by the way? Did you two arrive in the same vehicle?
Not the same vehicle.
Oh, do you know him?
I know him.
Oh, okay. You're not married to him or anything then?
No, we're
dating.
Oh, okay.
And I'm here because of her.
Oh, how interesting. Because you know how to make demands. Now, this hand, this part of you, the right hand, says, I'm not demanding. No, I'm just a little sweetie pie. But this hand is quite the demanding hand. How long have you known her?
About a year.
Oh, that's long enough to have seen that part of her. And it doesn't know how not to get its way, this hand. On the other hand, you're just fine and dandy as long as things are smoothing along. But if she, over here, this other one, doesn't get her way, well then, she has a very loud... The thing that is hard for you is something that you know how to do automatically. You don't have to learn. Just watch the videotapes. And if you can do 40% of what Kathleen can do, that's A+ for you. Yeah. That's only about that one issue. I'm talking about personal requests. I'm playing with you, but I'm talking about your ability to request. So, what would you say about your ability to request? Are you comfortable with your requestability? You think you're doing well with it?
It's sort of been like a lifelong thing to be able to do it.
So, how are you doing now? What would
Better
you say
than
that?
I used to be able to.
Okay. Because I'm saying that you're a half kind of be quiet and go along and half demanding requesty type. You're kind of half of each, you know, stereo headphones. Oh. Well, you'll be glad. This is an interesting life purpose, by the way. Your life purpose is about getting what you want and living your passions. So you get to the gates of heaven. You've heard me use that phrase here. You get to the gates of heaven, and there's only one question on your questionnaire, and it is, did you live your passions? In other words, did you do what you wanted to do? If it's a yes, well, they throw the rose petals, and they bring you, I don't know, bagels and cream cheese, whatever you would like, okay? And they play the right music. Or, you know, chutes and ladders, start over, try again. Your whole life purpose is to say out loud what you want and not do what you don't want to do. Your life purpose is to learn how to ask so that you don't wind up painted into some untenable corner, which if you look at your history, you've had at least 3 corners that were untenable that you got there by not requesting. And when you're out of those things, you do all sorts of things for people, and any one of them would probably be fine. But it's to get out of those corners. In your case, your whole life purpose is about living your passions. To do that, of course, you have to be able to identify your passions, and that's what's trickier for your hands. How do you know if it's a true passion or just a passing fancy? That's part of your training program, delineating between those. True passion? Passing fancy. What Geiger counter do you use to understand the difference inside yourself between true passion and passing fancy? This is another way of decoding what your life purpose is about. That's not so easy. But you have a whole lifetime to practice. Next! Maybe more than one lifetime to practice. And I don't mean that unkindly, I mean that for all of us, you know? These are multi-lifetime training programs. By the way, there's so many different ways that a person's desire system can get polluted and malfunction. There's so many different markers in the hands that indicate desire system askew. And each of them is slightly different from the other, and each of them requires different remedial action to straighten out. Interesting to consider. Because do you know what you want?
Yeah,
with those big thumbs of yours?
Yes. You told me I'm the taskmaster.
Well, yeah, you got the biggest thumbs up. Well, the biggest thumbs in the room so far. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's like, self-reliant. Okay. So how much I'll do it myself do you have?
Yeah.
This much? So would you let Tina do stuff for you?
If I have to. No, I'm getting better.
So Thanksgiving is coming up. Mm. Is it going to be at your house?
Likely.
Who's going to be in charge of things? Now, my question is, would you let Tina be in charge of your Thanksgiving?
Are you capable of doing that?
That's not even the point.
And how do you handle it when people disappoint you? And I'll use different language for you. When people promise you, when they break their contract, which is not keeping their contract, specifically contracts with loved ones. How do you handle contracts with loved ones? So let's say Tina was a loved one, and she said she would take care of the turkey. And then it's your house, and everybody's there, and she said, oh, yeah, the turkey. Oh, yeah, I thought I would. I guess I didn't do the turkey. I got busy. You know, I was talking to Aunt Matilda for hours and hours, and we were talking about the turkey. This is tricky business in your life, contracts with loved ones. And part of your formula, there's a tendency, I believe, that when people do not keep their contract or break their contract with you, that mostly what you do is that you do all the turkeys forever yourself from then on, because your shoulders are big enough that you can. But that doesn't really move the game forward, because part of your challenge was to straighten things out with Tina. And you don't like to talk about that. You're so disappointed. And you don't know what to do, and you don't know how to impose a consequence. You start, that's your opening position. And whether or not you can arrange life so that you can count upon loved ones keeping their contract with you. If you can do that, that's like you asking to get the soup hotter. As a matter of fact, Richard, homework. Go to a restaurant, no matter how they bring you the soup, say it's not hot enough. When they bring it back and it's hot, insist that it's still not hot enough. You insist upon hotter. Then write me an email and tell me how your brain caught on. Tell me whatever happened to your neuron complex by doing that. Okay? Oh, that's interesting. Ah, it's even more interesting. I have no time to tell you about that. Ah, okay. Oh, let me double check. Son of a gun. It's a good thing I double checked. That's a whorl. No other whorls. To get a whorl on your left little finger when there are no... Oh, no, you have whorls on your thumbs. Yeah. Still, that's remarkable. Muhammad Ali had a similar life purpose. That's another one of the fingerprints that I just got recently, Muhammad Ali's fingerprints. That's very, very interesting. Ah. Not one of the more common ones. So we have three whorls. The left Apollo is the weakest of the loops, and the full whorl on left Mercury. What an unusual, statistically unusual combination. Okay. Yeah, here's what I like. I like you inspiring other people such that they can take care of their own selves for themselves. So you can take care of yourself. If I had a helicopter and there were 20 islands with 20 survivors all by themselves on 20 islands, and it's been 2 weeks since you got stuck on your island, and everybody had to fend for themselves, I come to your island last to save you. Because you're fine. You figured out a way to take care of yourself on your desert island. You got running water on both sides of the island. You got hot and cold running water. You figured out what to do. You're fine. I save you last because Tina needs help quicker. But what I'm suggesting is that when you're at your best, people that have come in contact with you are better able to survive and do things for themselves. You know, you might have taught them how to fish, but you don't do any of the fishing for them after the first bout of fishing. So how well Tina fishes determines on whether or not you get through the gates of heaven. Tina fishes and is self-reliant because she learned from you. They let you through, they play the music, etc. You fish for Tina, they send you back for another semester.
Okay.
Anyway, that's what I said. That's what I said.
Okay.
It's just what one person said. You can come to whatever conclusion you like.
Stop, stop, stop.
Let's all take a nice deep breath. Thank you.
Supposed to stop.
Ah, feels better over here already. Okay. Mm-hmm. Say your first name, please.
Eleanor.
Eleanor. Okay, Eleanor. You mind telling me how old you are, Eleanor?
75.
Okay. How's your energy?
Not real well lately.
Okay. You were designed to be an exaggeratedly energetic person.
Wait, if you want to, type in what this is.
Okay.
So you have a name for it. Okay.
Send it back.
Thank you.
Okay. Just wait a second. Yeah, these are extraordinarily dynamic, take charge type of hands. But they don't look take chargey at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And it's, you know, people can say you're only as old as you think you are, and there's truth to that. But then again, there's also truth to 75 is different from 25. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a difference. Take a look at the asterisk marking you have underneath your index finger on your left hand. Do you see it?
Mm-hmm.
That's a big deal marker. According to the ancient palmist, women who had that would marry the king.
Mm-hmm.
Men who had it would become the king.
You've
got to understand, in India, king meant more like the mayor.
Mm-hmm.
But still, it's, you know, like it's a high honor.
Mm-hmm.
That is a super achiever, very dynamic marker. And if you look closely, it's on a raised surface. Do you see what I mean mm-hmm. by a raised surface?
Yes.
Other markers of your hand also indicate a very dynamic, active, get things done type of personality. But the coloration of your hand, it's like they haven't been going to the gym enough recently, you know? You used to have bigger muscles than you have now.
Mm-hmm.
So I run into hands like yours a lot in Switzerland from specifically your gender and your age. And I see that a lot with women who, well, if you're 75, right,
mm-hmm.
you got born in a certain era
okay.
where becoming the king wasn't as available to your gender, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And multiply by 10 how not available it would have been in Europe,
mm-hmm.
even in a first world country like Switzerland, okay? So women who were dynamic doer, achiever, leaders usually picked a man to be the, you know, the power behind
mm-hmm.
the throne, because that was the closest they can get to doing it. That was what was available.
Okay.
Okay. However, it brings up an inevitable consequence. The man won't do it the right way because he's not you, and then you're going to be really annoyed with his lack of potency and the wrong way of doing everything, which is going to drive a wedge between you and the him involved. Okay. And it would be like a stage mother who had ambitions for Broadway and she makes her daughter do it, and her daughter just wants to, who knows, play chess instead.
Mm-hmm.
You follow the same thing. It's a power behind the throne issue. So here you are at 75, and the question that your hands are presenting before I look at the fingerprints is, can you step into your power in a way that's appropriate for you? So let's say that you were, before World War II, trying to step into your power in your gender. What was available, how did you do it, and how well did you step into your power? But it's, you know, you're not a teenager now. You know, you're a post-teenager, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So there are ways of stepping into your power that fit. There are others that you don't have the energy for, and it would, you know, a younger person should be doing the heavier lifting.
Mm-hmm.
But you're still challenged to step into your power in the ways that match you and your circumstances. And what that looks like, I'd have to talk to you for a while to find out. And it's going to get even worse when I tell you what's in your fingerprints.
Oh, boy.
So, well, yeah, there's a variety of different things, and I oversimplify for each case. But if you do what your fingerprints ask you to do, not only do you step into your power, but large numbers of people know about it.
Mm.
So to be in your personal power is insufficient for what your fingerprints mark. Your fingerprints ask you to have high visibility as you come into your power.
Mm-hmm.
that means people that aren't part of your close circle can see what you're up to, and you're influencing them. Or I don't like the word influence for you. I like you galvanizing. I'll leave you with that word. I like you galvanizing. And to galvanize, you need galvanese.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Nancy Reagan comes to mind.
This is different. This is different. So I'll take a breath as we move around the circle. Moving right along.
Dee
Dee?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I mean, you took like 3 semesters at the Know-It-All University, then you left because you thought it was just a bunch of bullshit at the Know-It-All school, so you never did quite get your degree. But you can keep up with the other Know-It-Alls when you are so inclined. Also, you're a little bit like Hoss Cartwright. Are you old enough to know who I'm talking about?
Yes.
Bum-ba-da-bum-ba-da-bum-ba. Students of a certain age don't know about TV, no less the dance. Okay. So, if you remember Hoss, did he get angry over every little thing?
Nope.
No. But any injustice foisted on people who couldn't stand up for themselves, like 10 guys ganging up on the Chinese fellow or the Indian, and they threaten them and they're going to lynch them, and ha ha ha, look what we can do. Pretty soon, Hoss Cartwright comes up and, you know, slow to boil, but when he boiled, he picks people and throws them 20 yards this way, 20 yards that way. They shouldn't have picked on the Chinese fellow when Hoss Cartwright came to town. Okay. So, I'm making a silly story for a reason here. Do you know the part of you that I'm talking about? The injustice fighter?
Yes.
How you're infuriated with injustice, according to your palmist. So, it would be very interesting for you to keep an injustice diary. 10 days. Regarding injustice, what I noticed today, dear diary. Well, I noticed something while I was stopping for gas. I noticed something in the newspaper. I know, whatever you know, it's unjust the way that the parking lot is arranged. Whatever. If you and I reviewed your injustice diary after 10 days, and we pored over it for a few hours, your best course of action moving forward is probably visible in your notes, whether you realized it or not. Because it really infuses your system when injustice comes somewhere where your eyes can see it, smell it, taste it, feel it. And that's a vital clue to what you wish to be up to in this life. Because, you know, Tina doesn't like injustice, but her blood doesn't boil at the same temperature your blood boils. And you could spot an injustice at 500 yards. She needs to be at 50 yards before she spots it. Your system is hyper-sensitive and hyper-responsive to injustice, according to me. And I think that's you know, when you were at the gate, when you were at the cosmic laboratory getting built, this is not a mistake. You know, you were built this way on purpose. And it's a clue to what it is that your mission is to do. Because, in effect, you're a canary in the coal mine. You know how the canaries work. They would die from the gas because they were smaller, and a smaller amount of gas would kill them. Then there wouldn't be a canary singing, and the miners would run out of the coal mine. Early warning system before more sophisticated devices. Well, you know, maybe it's not the right planet for you. There's so few injustices left. Okay, worlds on both Jupiter and Apollo, 3 loops elsewhere. And I'm telling Tina so she can have some fun, but I'm also saying it out loud to help me keep track. Okay. More or less the same on this hand, pending the little finger. Okay. Yeah, this is a public service life purpose, and you're the injustice, you know, you have the hyper Geiger counter for injustice type of thing. I also like you, just to take it one step further, I like you in particular standing up for people who do not have the power to stand up for themselves, legitimately do not. So, is House Cartwright fighting for corporate fairness and stuff like that? That's not the injustices that come to mind. But for people who are unable to fight the injustice that they're living with, because they're not like whiny or anything, they can't. Children, for instance, they don't have the tools to fight the injustices that come their way, etc. I particularly like that subset of the injustice zone for you.
Is this my lifeline?
Yeah.
And isn't that a little short?
Well, the lifeline doesn't say how long a person lives. What it says about the way your lifeline is built, what it says about you is that you need an activity, a job, that is more than a job, it's your identity. You need something to be up to. Like if I paid you $1 million to work here and then at 5:01 you're glad to leave, that's a bad job.